standard that we have contained, what people say the same infrared physics or a non-perturbative physics, this a momentum P3 appears actually explicitly in results for these objects and these objects, which is different from these guys. There's no explicit dependence, let's say, of P+. So lattice calculations can only be done at a finite P3, therefore there's power corrections. We heard a lot about this in Olivia's talk. And then in this language here of the quasi distribution in G and Coburgers, we have the following feature here. The ultraviolet behavior of this distribution and that distribution is different. In fact, in models you see, for instance, that the quasi distributions are all ultraviolet finite, while those distributions can be UV divergent. And this difference, however, is dealt with what people call a perturbative matching. And I think in the next talk we'll hear much more about that. Jung is one of the key players in that field. And I think this is what these people say puts this matching, puts this entire approach on a safe theoretical ground. This is in a schematic way, generic structure of a matching formula. The quasi-PDF can be written in such an OPE-type expression expressed with the standard PDF and the calculable coefficient function, or people call it a matching coefficient. And those matching coefficients are presently known to be up to one loop order. That could be an issue, I think, or a source of a systematic uncertainty, but that's a different topic. And then you have power corrections, target mass corrections, and other power corrections. Here again, I refer to Bologna's talk, who has perhaps state-of-the-art work available now. Now, I think another interesting development or important development was just that Radushkin.
So let me understand, does this limit this? This presumably limits things to kind of leading to those sorts of things? Or? So the matching criteria.
Oh, you mean if this can only be done for leading twist?
Yeah.
I don't think so. I don't think so. But so far, it has, to the best of my knowledge, not been explored.
And so then it's an expansion.
So, but this is standard expansion, like a relation between structure function and the particle distribution. It's just precisely the same thing, but for a different observer.
No, I thought the question is, let's say, if we want to do the same thing for the twist 3 part of the distribution, I think this has not been studied so far, but I believe it
and
would also work.
And principle, you get everything small x, which is not...
no, not too small x.
So where does it break down?
No, can you?
It might break down...
This is what my research.
You missed my talk.
That would be excellent.
You missed my talk. The problem is that in this power correction, there's about x squared to the denominator. There's not an expansion p, but expansion x times p. So small x you can
think of. I see.
Because
so
it's a q.
It's
just a q. You don't put your scaled polyhedral momentum in.
Just a comment that you know, on your left hand side, the F, which include actually hydrogen overall.
No.
Because the operator you have,
yes,
have
yes,
does not have
but,
fixed
but,
the twist.
But yes, but I mean that's how it is done, right?
Yeah. Yeah. So they have the right hand, they have twist corrections.
Yeah,
that's I think it's done.
So So I think Radushkin was the first one to explicitly suggest, if I'm not mistaken, to use for the unpolarized distribution rather than working with gamma 3, to work with gamma 0. And I think he at the time argued that it's better behaved with respect to power corrections. I'm not sure, I mean, how strong this argument is, but I think the second point here, I think, is relatively strong, at least in this machinery. A gamma zero is better behaved with respect to the question of renormalization.
But Lufthansa speaks this.
Right, but Yes, but still he proposed at that time.
Yeah, but to that is a minus gamma. What the thing is that no integral is it?
No, I'm not arguing that. I mean, he didn't work in the first place. It's a quasi PDF. But he was the one who said, actually, irrespective of whether we talk about quasi or pseudo, the one who said, work with gammas here. And in fact, you could actually, in principle, use, if you leave aside this complication here, you could use actually any linear combination of these two. In particular, gamma plus, which would be in the first place a natural thing to do. You don't modify the gamma matrix, and you just make you put your things here, the time to zero. But for gamma plus, you have actually this issue that you have mixing of the operator with other more complicated operators. This is really a serious issue. But for gamma zero, this is a lot. I will, for the quasi-GBDs, I will actually show results both for gamma 3 and for gamma 3. So, as we heard before here, I just refer again to Boyotti's talk. There's other suggestions on the market to compute the x-dependence of PDFs and related quantities. Some of them were proposed before the quasi-PDFs and or are related to the quasi-PDFs. So, now I come to very basic stuff. I will mostly talk about spectator model calculations here, and I want to spend just one page on that. The ingredients here is very simple. You have in mind just the three quark structure of the nucleon. You have one active quark, two quarks are left as spectators. You don't want to work with a two-particle system, so you couple them to a single particle. Either they can be coupled to spin zero, then we have a scalar dipole, or to spin one, then we have a vector dipole. This is a graphical representation of such a two-quark correlator nucleon here, the quark, and here the diquark, and you can calculate PDFs, GBDs, TMDs, etc., etc. So in the scalar diquark model, you can actually write down a simple approach density. The essential part here is just a coupling between the nucleon, quark, and the diquark. What is often done, not always, is that people, rather than using here a point-like coupling, introduce the form factor. You have some parameters there, which gives you also some freedom. This is actually not what we do in our calculation of the quasi-GBDs, which I'm going to discuss. There's a number of studies available in the literature. The parameters have been fitted, etc., etc. Let me skip over that point. It's an interesting technical point, but not so relevant for the flow of the talk. This is the first calculation in such a model of quasi-PDFs has been done by Gumberg and co-workers in 2014. They used both a scalar and a vector diquark, which allows them to calculate both a U and a D quark distribution. They used form factors at the nucleon quark-diquark vertex, and they didn't. They used a set of parameters that was fitted in a previous work. They did not look at what happens to the results if they vary the parameters. So he did a little more in that regard, and I will come to that. Here's their results for the up and the down quark in the proton. They show this quantity x times f1 tilde, which is nothing than what I call x times f1 quasi, this is a gamma matrix, gamma 3. U and D quark, the black curve here is the standard PDF in that model, and then the other, the colored curves are quasi PDF for different nuclear momenta, 1, 2, 3, and 4 GeV. And what you see is if you can go here in the model to somewhat larger nucleon momenta, let's say 2, 3, 4 GeV, there's a relatively wide range in X where the quasi-PDF is relatively close to the standard PDF, even more so for this model, for the down quark than for the up quark. At large X, you see very large discrepancies. And we see them all over the place in these models. And I think it's also related to in Lockyer's talk about higher twist combinations. They did not only study F1, but they also studied the quarkalicity and transversity distribution and the qualitative findings from these. There's a related study available which Barbara was involved, basically the same type of findings, particular issues at large X, and they propose also a method how one could improve the situation at large X, like a combination of quasi-PDFs and informational moments. I don't want to get into that. And there is also a calculation by Hobbs, also in a spectator type model, for pions and road masons, the PDFs, similar thing issues towards the end.
One question. So in QCD, this power corrections are like interesting higher twist interaction in terms for Gromov correlations. What you don't really model for, so is it like kinematical higher twist?
I mean, here in the model, it's basically it's kinematical effects only. I mean, in that regard, it's much more primitive than QCD. So all this discussion here has to be seen basically. Yeah, so here is some results from the lattice. So what is seen on the lattice, and I think you will say much more about that. And I think he can also, he knows that stuff in much more detail than I do, but here's what I extracted from. So this is calculations for the quasi-distribution with a matrix gamma zero, two calculations both at the physical pion mass. Came out this spring, U minus D in either case here. This is a calculation by Alexander et al. It's a busy plot where we have a total of six curves or error bands. Three of the curves are from lattice calculations and the other three curves are phenomenological parameterizations. The blue curve is the largest, for the largest nuclear momentum they could achieve is close to 1.4 GeV. It's this thing here. The lowest nuclear momentum is around 0.8 GeV, this is green band, which has the oscillation, and this red type band, this is for about 1.1 GeV. I think compared to this phenomenological extractions, given that these are still at the level of exploratory studies, it looks encouraging. That's what I would take from such a plot. Coming back to the discrepancies at large X, this is a logarithmic scale here. You see actually for all three nuclear momenta at large X, they have an issue, non-negligible issue. So really starting from 0.6, 0.7 or so, there's an issue. Now, if I go to the other calculation by Chen et al. And Yong is a member of that collaboration, this has been done at a larger nuclear momentum. To the best of my knowledge, there have been a lot of debates in the community how high in the nuclear momentum we can go in order to sufficiently suppress certain systematics. I'm not the expert in this, and I don't want to take anyone's opinion here. This green is a result of what they find for the quasi-PDF. It's remarkably small at large X, whether compared to this here, is just because this is at a larger nuclear momentum, or if something else is going in here, I don't know exactly. I don't want to belabor on that. For me, the main reason for showing also this plot here is this is the green is quasi, and then this matching is applied to get from the quasi PDF to the standard PDF. And what is not only seen in this calculation, you can actually see it in several papers, that after the matching, at large X, your partial distribution gets smaller. I don't know what physically the reason for that is. I just put it here as an observation. I'm sure the experts know why this is coming.
Do you have the correct support after matching? I mean, for finite E3, you don't have, like, you have support all the way.
It's actually good that you bring that up. That's an important point which I wanted to make here. The standard PDF has, of course, support for minus 1 to plus 1, while the quasi-PDF has support for minus infinity to plus infinity.
So
And to my understanding, the matching does not reduce the range of support for the quasi. Or please correct me if this is wrong.
The matching can be done for orders, and our patterns are well suppressed. We should expect to see the effect beyond x equals 1. It must be consistent with it. Now the matching is only at one order, and we have other systematic.
So this looks already.
Yeah,
almost too good. And we're not. I don't want to get into that. I just want
to understand how the convergence is at large. If you take the limit P3 to infinity at a given x, so you're saying that for x below 1, which is in the support of the continuum PDF, you just converge to the continuum PDF plus the power correction.
Yeah.
And for x larger than 1, you will go to 0 plus power correction.
Power correction would also go to 0.
Yeah, I'm talking about the asymptotic behavior.
Yeah.
1 minus x times P3, that should be bigger than lambda QCD. Otherwise, there is no match of PDF possible. Mm-hmm. So for this momentum, if they say if lambda QCD is bigger than, it means that if you go beyond 0.9, you go to the region where you have all twists of the same order. This is essentially a non-determinative region. So there is no matching possible in this region at all, and then beyond, of course. This is essential singularity in the twist expansion. The same happens at low x.
So you would basically say this very high x region is anyway unreliable.
It is like measuring a structure function F2, F2 squared, 100 dB. It's an interesting observable, but it's not related to partial distribution. It's the same here.
So anyway, I brought this up. I mean, I'm totally new to this field. I just did one work on that and try to connect the dots. And I have seen it just in a number of papers, this feature happening that they show the quasi-PDF, and then you get the matched after the matching, and then somehow it seems that the matching magically can cure this issue at large x.
For better comparison, we should have also party logarithmic near x equals 1. So now it's only a linear.
Yeah, but I think it would still be. I mean, here really, you can actually go down to whatever 0.6 or so. You clearly, here it's basically 0. Here it's clearly non-zero. But the nuclear momentum is different. And again, I know there's the groups you have been. Arguing over this, what is possible and what is not.
What about the x going to zero behavior from the positive side? This rise at small x, is that actually something seen in the in the simulation, or is that a parameterization artifact?
I think this is, in data you would see that also.
In the empirical PDFs, yes, you see it, yeah, but that's well understood. I'm saying.
Concerning the matching, I did not.
Does this actually come out of the lattice calculator of the correlator, or is this a parameterization?
I think this is from the lattice calculator.
So the green band comes from lattice matrix element, and the blue band is after you apply the logarithmic matching.
Yep.
Okay. So what the lattice gives you is really this green band, the green dashed line, which is your. It could be anywhere. I mean, your error is just.
Maybe I can have a comment. You have to be careful about small x region.
Yeah.
Because what you calculate is a function of z. Then you do the Fourier transform to get x dependence.
Yes.
And if you go to x of 10 to minus 2, say sufficient small x, x times p multiply z should be at least order 1 to give you reasonable Fourier transform. So we know the z from this part is a 0.3, 0.4, and p is all of a GeV, 3, 2 or 3 GeV. So the range you really have confidence in F should not go to 0.1.
I mean, yeah, both groups have been brave to. This goes down almost to 10 to the minus 2.
Yeah, but it doesn't look.
I mean, just taking the results, it doesn't look so bad. But I know, of course, that you cannot go to two small x. I don't want to put an explicit number.
It doesn't look so bad because something is assumed. So when you go from a coordinate space to a momentum space, when you make a Fourier transform. Fourier transform is mathematically not stable. So something, probably functional form is assumed. Something is assumed, which is very much hidden in these two papers. So I don't really know exactly
how they
something like this.
The Fourier transform is always. Until you have a maximum value of V in coordinate space. So if you make a direct Fourier transform, you would anticipate a oscillatory free behavior in the X space. So you Fourier transform from a finite region of you always get a oscillatory free behavior. While in the LP3 Fourier transform, we actually Fourier transform the derivative of the coordinate space correlation data. Assume that the derivative of the correlation beyond the transition point is negligible and it's zero. So that's the assumption we made.
This is probably also behind the fact that you get that long here. But that's a different one. As a side remark here, I was actually wondering why were three phenomenological curves put on here? And it's not written explicitly, but you see here. They deviate. Right? So how well do we know that from phenomenology? Right? So people could say, well, they're not so bad after all. Yeah. No, but it's an important point.
So you sure about that? I thought they agree with each other.
No, but you see here the yellow one here at not too small x clearly deviates.
Well, the distribution actually should agree on it.
I don't know, I haven't checked it yet.
In this way of plotting the PDF, you plot really quarks and anti-quarks. It's not valence and see what the phenomenologists usually extract, which are it's really quarks and anti-quarks. Yes. What you see on the right is the valence quark plus two times the see quark distribution. So any uncertainty on D bar minus U bar affects the left side and the right side.
But still, I mean, there's a point
the
that
population doesn't include this connector.
There's a point that if the curves are correctly plotted, there is an uncertainty with this curve. That's all.
What did A, B, and T stand for?
I don't know.
It's not a hierarchy, right?
No. Sorry?
No, it's a
is it?
Oh, they are still in the box. I saw there's only theta and MS.
Yeah. So I think one cannot make the point that anything of this is ruled out, but I think if someone plots this, just a valuable parameterization, there is a discrepancy, there's an issue. At least one of them underestimated the error. So let me wrap up this part by just a few words about further model calculation. I'm not defending any model here, I just want to give an overview of what is on the market. I think this is really, reference-wise, it's a complete list of what we have right for the models. Roberts and co-workers did calculation for pion and kaon with beta wave functions, both the distribution amplitude and the parton distributions. And this is here for the pion, the quasi-distribution amplitude. The standard distribution amplitude in that model is the black curve here. And then the others here are quasi-distribution for different pion momenta. The largest pion momentum is for the green curve. And you see a similar feature what we saw before. In a considerable X range, they come relatively close. But then near the endpoint, especially the relative error can get large. And they found similar results for the distribution of the Kaon and also for the PDFs of Pyon and Kaon issues again. There's a related study of quasi distribution amplitudes for pions and kaons in the non local current quark model. I don't want to get into that. And also, there's two interesting papers by these people here. They studied quasi distribution, pseudo distribution, connecting it somehow with evolution of TMDs. Again, I don't want to get into that. I found interesting that these papers here appeared this year. The two groups calculated quasi-distribution amplitude and quasi-PDFs in two-dimensional QCD, more precisely in the large NC limit, which is a toothed model. And the way the papers were motivated is the following, that in, remember I said that the difference in the UV behavior of the quasi-distribution and the standard distribution is the source for non-trivial matching in this approach. Now, 2D QCD has no, basically no UV divergence. Therefore, you would expect that if you calculate quasi and standard distributions and you put the Hadron momentum to infinity without any need for non-trivial matching, the results are the same, and this is actually what they thought. And in fact, they also say it's even a stronger test of the method that the infrared physics is the same, because in this two-dimensional model, the infrared divergences are more severe than in the four-dimensional. So anyway, that's I think essentially all the papers that are on the market concerning model calculations. So let's now get to the second part. Well, I thought it would be done by that time, actually. GPDs. GPD correlate, I use the standard symmetric frame. Operator definition for the standard GPD is the same thing as for the forward PDFs. The only difference is that we here have a different momentum than here, which introduces here a dependence on the momentum transfer. That is, these objects are parameterized in terms of the number of GPDs. X, well known of course, is now the average plus momentum of these two quark lines divided by P plus the psi variable and T, well-known kinematic relation. I bring this up here since we use as variables psi and delta perp as independent ones and not T. So if you now want to go to quasi-GPDs, it was actually already written down in principle in Chi's original paper. You do the same thing as for the forward PDFs. You put the time to zero and you have a spatial code. And again, you get now an explicit dependence on the three component of this average momentum of the incoming output. And now, as I said, we look at both definitions for the vector operator, with the matrix gamma zero and with the matrix gamma three, defining here on this quasi GPDs HQ0, EQ0, HQ3, and EQ0.
Andreas, a priori, you should have it. Depends on P3 as well as delta. Are you, your right hand side depends on two independent vectors now, which is P and delta. So you can a priori say it depends only on P3.
You mean at this level?
It might depend independently on P3 and.
This for sure here. I don't want to argue with you. About that here in the correlator, but these here are just having a dependence. Everything can be, everything which goes beyond the standard GPD variables can be exclusively expressed through this. So the quasi GPDs again now depend, we call it X because this is done in the community, but it's a different X than this one. This is again K3, the average, the three momentum, the average over the two quarks divided by P3, standard psi, T, and P3. Now, this change here from standard X to, one could actually call it X tilde, replacing plus by three, it looks tempting to, rather than work with psi, to work with psi, what I call psi 3 tilde. Replace in the standard definition of psi plus by three. Now, this object is in the large P3 limit is exactly the same as psi, but for finite P3, the numerical difference can be significant. And he chose actually to work with the standard psi. You can't one-to-one relate.
But this difference has to be considered as what? Is it power correction?
I would actually say the way to go to get the most reliable results is to work with psi. Because I want to get a calculation for a GPD at a given psi value. And I don't see a need to change this curious value. Because I can unambiguously relate that thing here to this. You could actually also use a zero component here. Doesn't matter. When limit is equal to infinity, it's the same.
But I think it's related to the fact that even in the post, we have ambiguity in the time side. If we have to go to a different plane. So I think it is just what I would call another kinematic correction.
It is a kinematic, it's true, it's a kinematic correction, but let's say if I want to get a result for a GPD using that approach at a psi value of 0.2, for instance, I would prefer actually to, if I can, to work here in the quasi-GPDs with exactly that value. I know that the corrections are at the same level as other corrections.
It's a similar question that in the Minkowski space you have psi and you have a Bjorkian exercise. Difference is that psi is essentially your theoretical variable that you construct, and Bjorkian exercise is what you measure. Okay, and that's it's minimized. And that is and you have some relation between them, which depends on the frame. So here, if you sit on the lattice, you measure some kinematical variable on the lattice, so you don't have any pluses. You can define it something on the side. But then, when you match to your distribution on the right cone, or to the normal GPD, you will have also to match your relations between psi and
I don't know what. I don't know exactly what can or should be done on the lattice, but here in the model, I found it the logic clearest. If I don't need to change the psi variable, I don't do it. That's basically it's different for x, even in the model. So unfortunately, in the model, I cannot get a one-to-one relation between this x and this x. The only thing that was done on quasi-GPDs before our simple model study here were first works on the matching. So one page on analytical results, well, those who are familiar with this type of calculations will appreciate it. The others are asked to whatever look out of the window for a couple of minutes. This is the lowest non-trivial order expression in this model for this quasi-GPD correlator here in the denominator. You see the two quark propagator denominators, denominator of the spectator, and numerator of quark propagators, arbitrary gamma matrix. And in particular, here we have no integration over K0.
You integrated over K3 first.
That's basically, I mean,
okay, so you're not integrating, not exactly.
So if you if you're familiar with this type of calculation, if you calculate the standard PDF or GPD, at this point you have a K minus.
Right.
So this is now replaced by a K zero. And then you can work this out, project on H and E, can do it for gamma zero, gamma three, etc. This is just one example of basically the numerator which we get for HQ with a gamma matrix zero. And well, there's a kinematic variable which I did not define. I call it delta, which for P3 to infinity goes to 1. It's not so important. Another point, which again, perhaps only the experts will appreciate, is the following. We have a term which is independent of K0, 1 which is linear in K0, and 1 which is goes like K0 squared. Now again, if you do these calculations for standard distributions, leading twist at this level, the corresponding variable is k minus, and there's no k minus in the number. If you go beyond leading twist, you get 1 power of k minus. Then you do the k minus integral, this contour integration. You look at the poles here, and you see that the position of the poles can change if I go from the D-club to the other region. And at that point, the explicit power of k minus in the numerator can cause trouble and give rise to discontinuities. And this is exactly what Fatma Aslan talked about on Tuesday. Here, we do also use contour integration to the k zero integral, but you can readily verify that the position of the k zero poles doesn't care about whether I'm in the orbit or the D-club. And so there's no issue whatsoever with having some powers of k0 here in the numerator. These quasi-GPDs are continuous at x equals plus minus psi, and they keep being continuous even going beyond leading twist, unless perhaps you go to the extreme limit that p3, strictly speaking, goes to. So that was actually one point I was interested in seeing what happens with these quasi-GPDs at the crossover point. If they were discontinuous, I could not use them because I get results which break that message. So that was honestly for me the major motivation to get into this.
What is the delta?
Delta is the square root of 1 minus and then a fraction m squared minus t divided by 4 divided by. Okay. I have to look it up. But it's divided by p3 squared.
Can you consider the same way, so to say,
quasi-double distributions?
Probably, yeah.
Because that might be interesting.
No, can probably be done. So, anyway, so that's all I wanted to say. Now, from a practical point of view, this was very important. In all the cases for H and E, gamma 0 and gamma 3, we keep actually the integral, we keep KP per finite, and we send P3 to infinity, and we see exactly that analytically the results match with the standard GPD integrand, which is, in a sense, reassuring of the results of the calculation and of the method, the quasi-GPDs in general, at least in this approach. Let's now come to the numerical results. I want to spend one page here just to say a few words about the parameters which enter. We have, of course, the coupling, nucleon quark diquark coupling. We choose that to be 1. The actual value doesn't matter because we just want to see how the quasi distributions compare to the standard distribution. So it could also be 10 or 100, doesn't matter. The masses must satisfy that the nucleon mass is smaller than the sum of the spectator mass and the quark mass. In most of the results that I'm going to show, we use these values here, 700 for the spectator and the constituent type quark mass for the quark here. These values are actually very similar to what was used in that study, which we talked about. It turns out, and I will show some sensitivity of results on varying these masses. It turns out actually that this choice here is almost optimal when you want to minimize the discrepancy between the quasi distribution and the standard distribution.
Kind of
just in the sense of observation.
Yeah, but this is kind of unrealistic because it's so close to the proton mass, it's very weak binding kind of.
Jerry, bear with me for a couple of minutes. You will see how the essential results or some of them change if I go much higher.
Can I ask a question? Did you say that also, even beyond the leading, there is the expected quasi-GPDs are continuous at x equal to plus minus. But we know that if you take the thin center and you should recover the standard GPD.
Yeah. Right. No, I think what is going on, I mean, I paid attention to what Fatma was saying on Tuesday about this twist three calculation. She said the going forward, not off forward, she said that the twist three quasi PDF, if P3 goes to infinity, the analytical result at some point exhibits a delta function. And I assume the same thing will happen here, that for the twist 3 quasi-GPDs, as long as P3 is finite, they are continuous. But in the strict limit that P3 goes to infinity, you can get a discrete. Well, this is not in the twist 3, but what could be done actually at the twist 2 level, we know that the derivative of the twist 2 standard GPD in this model at the crossover point is discontinuous, and we should be able to see it actually in the derivative of the twist 2. But that's actually a point I was interested in, but I saw that Fatma, they had already done something. I was exactly wondering about that point, whether the quasi-parton approach can capture that feature at the twist 3 level. We can talk more about that. Right? Yeah. It's a natural question. I think I stopped here. So for the momentum transfer, I show just exclusively results for delta part equals 0. We use a cutoff for the K-prop integration of 1 GdV, but I also want to say we did look at variations of these two parameters within a reasonable range. Delta prop we went up to 1 GdV, and for the cutoff, the 4 GdV or even higher, the general results are not enough.
Why do you need to make kinetics? You cannot calculate the
I want to show a curve at the end of the day. I mean, you're basically asking whether one can carry that.
Yes.
In principle, I think it can be done, but it's not trivial because you have a number of scales.
Why bother?
So there is actually no need. So all what we wanted to see analytically, namely this match here at the level of the integral, we saw. And beyond that, what really matters at the end of the day is how the things behave in that. It's I think it's possible, but it's not totally true. It's more complicated than in QCD, where if you would work with a massless quark or so, massless gluon, here you have many scales and really, I think, can get messy. So, And finally, we played also a little bit with the form factor. It's somewhat delicate to do that. I don't want to get into the details, but you can trust me that overall the results do not change.
How many styles do you have?
I have just 5. So let's start with quasi-PDFs in that model. I apologize, everything is a little small here. This is F1 for the matrix gamma 0. This is the same thing for matrix gamma 3 for our standard values of the masses. The black curve, which you can hardly distinguish from the others, is the standard PDF. And then we have the quasi PDF, these colored curves here. And you see if the P3 is, let's say, 2 GeV or larger, the quasi PDF again are close to F1 in a wide range of x. For both, doesn't matter whether we work with gamma 0 or gamma 3. For somewhat larger momenta here, there's hardly any difference in the model. So in the following, I will almost exclusively show results for the matrix gamma 0. This similarity goes on as before the quantities.
This is the unpolarized.
That's just the unpolarized.
So you get a negative anti-quark distribution.
We get, in a sense, that would be a negative anti-quark quasi distribution.
Presumably it would remain negative in the P3 going to infinity limit, or that.
Well, what will happen is that I come back to this point in a second. It's actually a very interesting point in the model. What's going on here at around x equals zero? At large x, we see this discrepancy. I show a plot on the next slide, which makes this even more explicit. So now coming back to what's going on at small x, here we see also considerable discrepancies. The standard PDF at x equals 0 is discontinuous in the model. When you come from positive x, you end up here with a finite value. For negative x, it's related, as Christian already said, to the anti-quark distribution, which in that model, to that model is zero. So at x equals zero, we get basically a drop here to zero. So it's discontinuous. And since the quasi distributions are continuous at that point, there's basically no way around that they have to go to zero here, that there's a kind of mismatch. Now, one can ask the question, and there's certainly people in the room who know better than me how to think about that point. What do we know about x equals zero from phenomenology? I would say it's not continuous either, right? So here we would have like quark distribution. We go to zero. The experts say that it's even divergent, right? And then for negative x, because F1 quark distribution at negative x is minus the anti-quark distribution, which is positive. So we would have something which is down here. And I mean, existing phenomenology would not allow me to make a statement that this thing is continuous. But we don't know exactly what's going on at x equals zero, right?
But the GPD is discontinuous at x equals zero. It's because it's defined by a particular limiting procedure. And
I come actually back to that. I found it interesting just in the model. Since you bring that up, because to follow up on that point, if I get to the GPD, I squeeze in here the other region, and what we will see in the model, everything becomes continuous. The GPD in the model is continuous at any point. And so basically, if no matter how small the psi is, then in a very narrow herbal region, the GPD drops to zero and then is zero for x smaller than minus.
I should say the PEF, if you regard it as a universal function of x, from minus one to one, but where positive x part is quark distribution, the negative export is minus the anti quark distribution. That function has a jump at x equals zero, but then it's just a matter of definition.
Good.
Yeah.
So then, it's not a model artifact.
This is how it's related to the correlator. The physical correlator has a jump, and it represents one positive function on one
but
side.
But for the GPD, this disappears no matter how narrow the urban region is. No matter how small
the
size.
Starting with finite psi, and then you have a similar behavior at x equals plus minus psi.
Plus minus psi, at least in the model, it's continuous.
It's continuous.
Yeah.
Maybe just a quick comment. We don't try to compare apple with oranges here. For the PDF, x tilde is not x. When x tilde goes to negative, does not mean x plus is negative.
So it's not
necessarily. It can be.
But not necessarily.
Yeah, we have
all the range.
Yeah, we have no model independent relation between x and x tilde.
There's an x tilde is, like, as you say, is kc.
Right.
KZ can be plus minus, even though
that's not here. So, to highlight a little more what's going on here at large X, which we have seen over and over again, we plot here that what we call the relative difference, F1 minus the quasi distribution normalized to F1. And you see that in the large X range, things are fine, but a very large x here starting from 0.8 or even a little earlier, the thing here blows up to be a little more quantitative in the model. For P3 of 2 GeV, we can hardly go beyond x equals 0.8 if we want to have this relative difference somewhat under and I think, at least in the model, the main cause of what's going on here is exactly this mismatch between standard x and the, let's call it x tilde. In a simplified version of the model, you could actually quantitatively relate the two. And what you will find is as x goes to 1, x tilde can go to infinity. So that would mean in the model, if you want to compare actually a quasi a standard distribution at an x which is close to 1, you should better compare it to the corresponding quasi distribution at a much larger x. But again, even in the model, if here, if we treat that complete, we cannot write down an exact relation. It's only if you use the so-called cut graph technique, which strictly speaking, we cannot use for quasi PDFs. And it's true, it's a higher twist effect. Strictly speaking, it's a higher twist effect which would go away if P3 goes to infinity. And so again, we have seen that at least some lattice calculations see also this issue at large x. But again, this was just me observing some plots. The situation may improve after the lecture. The last thing before I show two slides on GBDs is to give a little bit new impression of the parameter dependence. If we vary the spectator mass, it changes actually drastically F1 and the quasi PDS in the entire X range. If we vary the quark mass, it changes these two mostly just at smaller x. Now, what really matters for our study is more this relative difference. And in that case, we see that the impact is much milder. This is a relative difference, and the study is a function of the quark mass. And we have here three curves. One is a constituent quark mass, 350 MeV. Here is 100 MeV, and this is just a current quark mass of 10 MeV. And you see that the curves for the relative difference basically don't care about that change. While there is more sensitivity if we make a change of the spectator mass from 0.7 GeV, 1.0, and 1.5 GeV, the larger the spectator gets, this is a kind of general robust feature in these calculations, the larger is the discrepancy between the standard and the quasi distribution, which in principle I can also see in the equations this is coming from.
So I want to make a comment about that before you go on. The fact that the smaller the MS, the better the agreement, is a nice finding in the model calculations that you have, but it has no particular meaning, I think, because it's a model parameter. You don't know what that is.
Yeah.
Now, actually, I've been studying these kinds of models for a long time because I'm trying to put them in the nucleus in a covariant way. I think that, and I even published on these models, I'm going to say, it was applying to me as well as everybody else, but I think that these models with this point-like coupling and propagators, and even with a form factor, are not as instructive as you might think because they don't include effects of confinement. Mm-hmm. And if you would take your external particle to be slightly off shell, you get weird stuff happening, especially if the sum of these MS and MQ gets to be close to the proton mass. You really have some wild dependence as you go off shell, which I think is indicative of the simplicity of the models.
Yeah,
just a warning.
Yeah, I mean, again, this type of model that we use, maybe, yeah, mostly in the T&D community. Also, GPT community fitted some parameters. Actually, this relatively low value of the spectator mass is actually what comes out of a number of fits for this.
Well, if you want to get the proton radius right, the number is 0.7 and 0.35.
Yeah. I mean, all what I'm interested in here is really some general features. I wanted to get a feeling of what's going on, the large X behavior, and also in particular what's going on in the urban region and around X and
yeah.
So this is now, I have two pages on GPTs. Unfortunately, everything is somewhat smallish here, and then I will do that. So this is now the quasi GPTs HE, and you have three plots here for different values of Xi. 0.01, 0.1, and 0.4. Now you cannot see it here, you can see it on the next slide where I will zoom into the other region. But as I said before, the standard GBD actually, no matter how narrow the urban region is, becomes continuous. So this jump which we have at x equals 0, if I squeeze in an urban region, this is xi of 10 to the minus 3, the thing is continuous. Just very rapidly in the model, the GBD drops to 0 and that is 0 for negative, for x smaller than minus xi. And well, again, there is actually overall not too much difference between H and E, the general behavior at large x, etc., etc. We see preserve the issue at large x. One thing which is a qualitative result in this model, if I make psi larger, the issue at large x also increases. So if you look somewhat carefully in this region, very small psi, and here largest psi, there's more of an issue actually, the very large psi. Last remark here on this, I said I've seen in lattice calculations where the matching cures somehow the large x issue. Now for E, there is at least to one no longer the matching because E is ultraviolet finite. So if such an issue would be seen, at least the matching would not happen. To cure that problem. And so let me finally just zoom a little bit into the urban region. H and for xi 0.01, here xi 0.4, and the same thing for E. So here you see this rapid drop of the standard GBD, and then you see in this very narrow urban region, even if you go to large nuclear momenta, you cannot capture that feature. This is just, let's say, the trace of the issue which we have for the standard PDF at x equals 0. If we use a very small urban region, but the situation, same situation here for E, but the situation becomes much more positive if we go to large psi, a value which I think can be reached at the Jefferson lab. There's a considerable range in the urban region where this curves here. So they don't have to go to too high nuclear momenta for that. So maybe this is something where in the future at some point lattice cubes could contribute because we don't know too much about these GBDs in the urban region. All right, so I don't have to repeat all that. Let me right away jump to the outlook. I think it's fair to say that in the future, lattice QCD may provide new important results. People just start working on that. Yong will probably tell us the state of the art. This will be first exploratory studies, but if we send a few years down the road, I can anticipate that, let's say, in 5 years, lattice QCD may provide first results on GBDs which are useful, that go beyond models. And keeping this in mind, then really in the future, a combination of experimental data, and what I have to bring in EIC here, and input from lattice QCD may be the ideal way to go in order to pin down this multivariable complicated functions. I really didn't mean to take so much time. I thought that would be done.
Yes, 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 yes.